I'm pleased to introduce Paul Barker. He and I were colleagues in Peace Corps in Iran many years ago. Paul Barker first traveled to Iran in 1968 as a student at Lewis and Clark College. Later he earned an MA in Islamic Studies from UCLA. In 1976 he completed 5 years of Peace Corps service in Iran, and since then he has made return trips in 1999, 2014, 2016, and 2019. Paul and Nora retired to the Eugene area following over 3.5 decades of international relief and development work in the Near East and East Africa. Their overseas experience includes 11.5 years in Afghanistan, 5.5 years in Iran, 1.5 in Israel, Palestine, 6.5 in Egypt, 6 in Ethiopia, 3 in Sudan, and 4.5 years in Tanzania. Since retirement, Paul has undertaken 2 short-term assignments, one in South Sudan for CARE and one in Afghanistan for Save the Children. Paul keeps up with current events concerning Iran through editing the monthly Advocacy Bulletin published online by the Peace Corps Iran Association. So please help me welcome Paul Barker.
I want to start my talk with a bit of background because I did spend all those years in Iran, and I think it's useful to understand a bit more of the history, the culture, the people, even the architecture. It's useful. Thank you, Bruce, for the introduction. I did very much enjoy our year in Shiraz together. That was a memorable time for both of us. Tom Woods also was in the Peace Corps in Iran. Hi, Tom. Welcome. There's a few of us in Shiraz. Actually, there's over 1,700 Peace Corps Iran volunteers over the 15 years that Peace Corps was in Iran. So, this is the concern that keeps me talking and advocating about Iran issues. Are we being misled into another disastrous war? These are huge eggs. They're not Easter eggs, these are Nowruz eggs. It's an egg which is used for as part of the celebration of the new year. And Iranians are very clever. They celebrate the new year on the first day of spring because everything is starting anew on the first day of spring. So this is a new thing. I didn't see this when in the Peace Corps, but I saw this a few times more recently in our trips there. And you see young men and women decorating these eggs and a joyous celebration of the new year. The Persian says, says the same thing English does, may every day be a new day. In the last few years, I've made a few trips back to Iran, so these different lines just roughly show where we went on these different trips. The green line to the left is the most recent one that Nora and I were on in February, March this year. Some of it is a major tourist route from Shiraz to Yazd, Isfahan, and back to Tehran. Almost every tourist that goes to Iran does that, but we saw a lot of other things as well. We think of Iran as being a land of great deserts and wastelands. It also has some very inspiring, interesting mountains and a lot of snow in the winter. Snow melts and provides water for agriculture in some of these famous Persian gardens. And it also, this year, caused a lot of serious flooding. Well, if you can see all these cars being washed down by the river in Shiraz, the town that Bruce and I lived in. It's the most serious flooding they've had on record in Iran. It particularly impacted Shiraz, but it was felt in over 2/3 of the provinces of Iran. Over 80 people were killed in Iran in the floods, over 20 of those in Shiraz alone. And it's hard to see here, but sometimes there's people hanging out the windows of cars as they wash down the river. It's reflective of several things. One is poor planning. This is usually a dry riverbed. And so they built a highway that goes down the dry riverbed because it's faster to get places on highways. But if you get a flash flood, that doesn't do very well. But since they'd never had a flood like this before, nobody expected it to come quite so suddenly. Horrible thing. Actually, our guide's father-in-law was killed in this flood. It also is a reflection of climate change and all that heavy snowpack we saw in the mountains. It ended the drought, but it melted far too fast when they had, what was it, about 6 inches of rain in a few hours in Yasuj, just northwest of Shiraz. We think of it as being a land of deserts, but this is near the Caspian Sea in the north, and a little village, Masule. And it's forested. It reminds one very much of Oregon. And so Oregon Peace Corps volunteers felt at home up there. But it does have deserts. The center part of the country has these vast empty deserts. And when you say desert in Iran, it's dry and there isn't much there. It's not like Eastern Oregon and it's sand, right? And that's about it. I've got a few pictures of domes, because domes tell some of the story of Iran. This is a Sasanian hunting palace. It's 1,700 years old, so that's fairly old. But the interesting thing about this particular dome is this. It's called a squinch. Can you see the squinch? It's where the square bottom joins the round top. It makes that transition. Is an architectural innovation that was developed in Iran by the Sasanians and then migrated around the world. So if you're ever in a dome that has a square base, you can thank the Sasanians. It is an 800-year-old dome built by the Ilkhanids in Sultaniyeh. It's the third largest brick dome in the world after the cathedral in Florence and Hagia Sophia in Istanbul. So it's a big old dome with very fancy, intricate brickwork. They didn't deal with colored tiles in those days, but they did very fancy brickwork. A more modern dome, this one sort of unique. This is the tomb of Ibn Hamza in Shiraz. The three ladies in front include my lovely wife, my lovely life's sister and her partner. There are two times in the whole trip in Iran they had to dress up in chadors. This was one of them. The other was the Tomb of Daniel. And this is inside that tomb. It's an intricate cut mirror work. This is a tomb of a Sufi poet, Shah Nematollah Vali, in the town of Mahan. Tombs are often inside gardens, so this is inside a beautiful garden. And there's this interesting old Sufi sitting in the corner of the mausoleum reciting Shah Nematollah's poetry. Another tomb in Shiraz is the famous poet Hafez. My first verse of Persian poetry came from Hafez. It was Jange haftar domelat hamira ozbene chunadidan hagiyat rahi afsanezadan, which I repeat because it means that the war between 72 nations put everyone in suffering. Because they did not see truth, they created fairy tales. It's the truth that we too often repeat. Inside the dome is this beautiful intricate mosaic work. Dome of Sheikh Lutfullah in Shiraz, in Isfahan. Nora was going to correct me, I'm sure. It's on this big square. And inside the mosque is this incredibly intricate design on the ceiling of the dome. And if you look even closer, it's even more intricate. It's just amazing detail. And so, very fine artwork, very highly refined culture. I traveled to Iran, as Bruce mentioned, in 1968 with Dr. Rasek, and he liked to say, when the Persians were building these mosques in Isfahan, the Americans were groveling in the mud at Jamestown. So keep everything in perspective. This is a Safavid bridge from the 16th century. There used to be a river here. Actually, sometimes there is a river here now. But they dammed it further upstream, part of the ecological missteps that Iran has made. And so it's an occasional river now, sadly. But it's an amazing bridge. This is a more modern bridge. This one's in Tehran. It's a pedestrian bridge designed by a young woman architect who won a competition. Again, my wife, her sister, and her partner, and me. This bridge is on three different levels. It's got coffee shops and tea shops and restaurants on it. It's a beautiful piece of architecture. It connects two parks and it overlooks a freeway, a super highway, which has also got nice gardens in it. So this Iranian orientation to detail is appreciated. Traveling to Iran, the easiest way to get there if you're an American is to be a tourist, and so that's how I've gone the past three times. It's sometimes difficult to break away from your tour and see your friends, which is one of the main reasons I want to go, but I managed a few times on this trip. So the chap on the right, I knew in my first couple years in Iran, he was about 8 years old then. When this picture was taken, was a deputy minister of education in charge of budgeting. So he'd moved pretty far up from this little village in Khorasan. And then after I left, he moved to Kuwait, where he's the headmaster of an international school. Did you know Madine? Okay. Madine, the woman on the left, was one of our students in the tribal high school in Shiraz. She came from a family of tribal carpet weavers, and so her parents were illiterate. She and her brothers graduated from either teacher training schools or university. Their children are all doctors or PhDs. And so it's an amazing sort of transition over a couple of generations. Another student from Bidocht, he flew from Mashhad down to Bidocht to Kerman to see us. He spent his life as a teacher, but you can't make a good living as a teacher in Iran, especially with the sanctions and so on. So he makes his additional living in the real estate business, and he's done well enough to afford a plane ticket to Kerman to see me. Older picture, another student of mine in Bidocht, and this is another shrine in Bidocht for the Nematolis sect. This guy, one of my favorite students, but he, after the revolution, joined the Mujahideen al-Khalq. It's a sort of a Marxist, Islamist sort of weird cult you'll hear more about later. And he kind of joined them in the opposition to the Shah, and it became a yet more weird organization later, and he left them. But because of his association, he lost his teaching job and had to make his career raising sheep and goats and cows, the family tradition. A couple other students. The one on the right is Khosrow Gudarzi from the tribal high school, and the one on the left is Hossein Abdulazadeh. First time my students from these two different towns met. Hossein is an interesting guy. He was my very best student. He went off and got scholarships for a special high school in Mashhad and then a special technical university in Tehran. And then this revolution happened and he joined the line of the Imam and helped take over the American embassy. So I've got one former student who's a Marxist on this side, another who joined the line of the Imam and helped take over the embassy on that side. And you wonder what you teach people sometimes. To me, an important thing is he looked me up when I was in Tehran this time. He'd heard from other former students, and he wanted to see me. And what we heard repeatedly throughout our trip to Iran is we have no problem with the American people. We worship the same God, we eat the same food, we have the same hopes for our families. Our problem is the American government. And some people are more and some people are less political with that sentiment, but we did not find any anti-American sentiment amongst the people we talked with. And we traveled pretty far off the beaten track in Iran. These are some young women we found in a public bath. The public bath is now a wax museum, so it's okay to be in there. But they're interesting. You kind of look at those faces and the pink hair, and the amount of hair you see, it's not your image of a very repressed conservative people. These are young women who are out and enjoying a bit of freedom and traveling. They're not from Kerman. They're with a group from someplace else, I forget where. But they wanted their picture taken with Maureen, Nora's sister, and her friend Loretta. And Iranians love to have their pictures taken with foreigners. Coffee. We could not find a good cup of coffee in Iran back in the day. Now you can find lots of good cups of coffee. This is a woman running a coffee cart in the Kerman Bazaar, quite happily selling us cappuccinos. Some other young women in the bazaar in Isfahan also selling us cappuccinos. We had a lot of cappuccinos. And just to, I know the message I'm trying to give is the essence of a relaxed, friendly environment. We were free to walk around by ourselves through the bazaars and meet people as we wanted and never felt any danger at all. This is an Elamite ziggurat. The Elamites were ancient people. You may remember them from the Old Testament. They used to inhabit southwestern Iran and a lot of lower Iraq. And they built these ziggurats, the hanging gardens of Babylon and the Tower of Babel, and all of these things were these Elamite ziggurats. This is about 500 BC, at least 500 BC, no, probably 1000 BC. It was a long-standing civilization, and a surprising amount of it is still there. Iran has an ancient history. They generally like to talk about it as starting with the Achaemenid Empire, so 500 BC, Cyrus the Great, who conquered everything from India to Greece and down through Egypt and Libya, creating the first real transnational, international empire. Before then, it was sort of all the Egyptians are Egyptians and all the Greeks are Greeks, but here it's all these other nationalities. This is a list of dynasties in Iran. They had lots of dynasties over this millennia, and it's hard enough for me to keep track of our presidents. You don't want to worry too much about all those dynasties, but the important thing is the sense of historic continuity and the depth of historical attachment that Iranians have. This cylinder is probably made out of clay. I think of it as the world's oldest time capsule. It was put under the gateway of a palace in Babylon by Cyrus about 539 or something BC, and it stayed there until it was uncovered by a British archaeological expedition in 1879. But what's important is what it says, and it's basically the world's first charter of human rights. So it guarantees everyone in the empire freedom of religion, freedom of movement. It ended slavery. It allowed the Jews to go back to Israel, Palestine. Very historic thing. This is actually a copy of the original. The original is in a museum in Europe. This is the tomb of Esther and Mordecai. You're familiar with Esther and Mordecai from the Old Testament. And Purim and the time when Esther was able to intercede with the emperor and save the Jewish people. Anyway, she and Mordecai were buried in this tomb in Hamadan, which has an ancient Jewish population. They didn't all go back to Israel. A lot of them stayed in Iran until today. And so it's a very ancient Jewish tradition there. We talked with the rabbi and asked him, well, what's it like to be a Jew in Iran today? And he said, well, you know, if you're not a Zionist, it's fine. And you can practice your religion, and actually they have television programs with Jewish holidays, and one of the most popular soap operas in Iran had to do with a Iranian sort of Schindler. He's a diplomat in Paris who saved up to 3,000 Jews by giving them Iranian passports. The Holocaust museums have not recognized him as much as some other people, but anyway, he's a very popular hero in Iran, who are proud of their efforts to save Jews in the Second World War. Tomb of Daniel, another biblical character. There are actually five tombs of Daniels around the world. This may be the oldest or the original, who knows? We also saw one in Uzbekistan about 6 months ago. And these are the same three ladies in different chadors this time. So a little bit about our complicated historical relationship with Iran. It started out fairly well. In the 19th century, the Presbyterians especially, but also other religious groups, sent missionaries to Iran, and they opened schools with modern Western curriculums. They opened hospitals and taught modern medicine. They opened the first girls' secondary school, so introducing school for girls. Lots of innovations. In the 1920s, Morgan Schuster was hired by the Iranians to sort out their financial systems and establish more modern accounting, because they had been grossly abused by the British and other European interests. So that was good. World War II, the US together with Russia and Britain occupied Iran to establish a supply route to get weapons to Russia, to the Soviet Union. General Schwarzkopf, not the one you know, but his father, helped establish the gendarmerie in Iran. President Truman convinced the Russians to leave after the Second World War. The Russians really wanted to keep Azerbaijan in the Northwest, but to our credit, we got them out. The U.S. There was also an American martyr in the 1905 constitutional revolution in Iran. So earlier images of Americans in Iran were really quite positive. And this is a gentleman you may have heard about, Mohammad Mossadegh. He was the prime minister of Iran in the early 1950s. He was most famous for nationalizing the oil. He thought it was an Iranian source of income, and it was not fair that almost all the wealth from the oil was going to the British. And so he nationalized it, much to the disgust of the British, who did a number of things to try and topple him, and finally he kicked the British out of Iran. The British then tried to get the Americans to organize a coup, and Truman wouldn't support this coup idea, but Eisenhower and the Dulles brothers did. 1951, Mossadegh was Time Man of the Year, and he came to the U.S., to the United Nations, to press his case for nationalization. He wanted to go to Philadelphia to see the Liberty Bell, because he was so much in admiration of American values of liberty and freedom, and he thought Americans should be champions of what he was trying to do in Iran. No such luck. The Americans under Eisenhower and Dulles organized a coup, toppled him from power, brought the Shah back from exile, and reset relations with Iran. It was a horrible setback to our reputation in Iran. It led to a number of unfortunate things. It was the first time we toppled a government, and our CIA folks thought we did so well, we should do this in Central America. And so we did it in a number of countries in Central America, and that legacy still haunts us today. It promoted some anti-American sentiment in Iran and generally around the world, Muslim world especially. And it contributed a lot to anti-American sentiment in 1979 when there was the revolution. And when the Shah left in 79, there was a lot of fear that the Americans were going to bring him back. And that's the main factor that probably led to the students taking over the embassy eventually. But for a number of years, there was a relatively positive relationship between the Americans and the Shah's government. Lots of aid and assistance. The Peace Corps was there for 15 of those years. Nixon decided that Iran should be our proxy in the Middle East, and they sold all kinds of billions of dollars worth of weapons to the Shah. Thought that's better if Shah buys them instead of us having to support him with our soldiers. Richard Helms, former CIA director, was appointed as our ambassador to Iran, and that sort of should send off some red flags, some concerns. Late 70s, the economy overheated and demonstrations and got very massive. Shah went into exile. Khomeini came back. Students, including my student, in the line of the imam, took over the embassy two times. The first time it was resolved peacefully. Second time lasted 444 days. There's questions of whether the Reagan campaign had back-channel communications with the Iranians to make sure that the hostages were not released until Reagan was in power. So this is the American embassy in Tehran today, the U.S. Den of Espionage Museum. And I've not actually been inside, but they do have, I've seen pictures of it, exhibits. Of different notorious things that Americans have done in Iran as well as other countries. And so there's this sort of legacy. And they've decorated the front of the embassy. You can't see it very well, but banners praising the students that took it over and condemning the Americans for what they did. So this complicated history. The U.S. did support quietly, but significantly, Iraq during the eight-year war with Iran. Reagan did try to swap arms for hostages, and he did, and the Iran-Contra affair, big scandal from the Reagan administration. We shot down a private Iranian airliner, lost 290 lives, and we did not apologize for it. George H.W. Bush made us point of saying he would not apologize for that. 2001, Iran was very forward in expressing sympathy to the Americans after the 9/11 attacks, and they offered Iranian air bases to the Americans. They offered search and rescue facilities. They provided links to Northern Alliance forces that the Iranians had developed over the decades, and played a major role in the success of the United States in toppling the Taliban in a very short period of time. They also played a big role in establishing the modern Afghan government. There was this Bonn conference to establish the new system of government where Hamid Karzai became the president. And the Iranians brokered a certain balance of ministerial appointments using their influence, and they insisted that the new Afghan government be committed to this global war on terror. So that was all positive in terms of American relations with Iran. And then to reward all of this, Bush declared that Iran was part of the axis of evil. And it's hard to know what was behind that decision, but it certainly tempered Iran's interest in collaborating with the Americans at that point. 2003, with the onset of hostilities in Iraq, Iran was feeling more vulnerable, and it offered a comprehensive set of solutions to negotiate with the Americans to solve all the outstanding problems between our countries, including difference of Palestinian-Israeli conflict. And this message was sent to the Americans via the Swiss ambassador who manages our affairs in Iran. And Cheney and Rumsfeld would not hear it. They insulted the ambassador for relaying the message, and a tremendous opportunity was lost. Traveling around Iran, we did find a couple of signs of official hostility towards Westerners. And this is one message we got at Pasargar north of Shiraz in 2014 and 2016. It was there. So the sense of being surrounded by these foreign enemies. But when we went back this year, the same sign had been replaced by a much more moderate one, which says, "To the youth of Europe and North America, message of Ayatollah Sayyid Ali Khamenei, leader of the Islamic Republic of Iran, I would like to you about Islam, particularly the image that is presented to you as Islam." It's a much less threatening message. And maybe that was reflective of changing approaches to the West with the nuclear agreement or something. Speaking of nuclear agreements, this is my Lewis and Clark College group in 1968. We're visiting this new facility in Tehran, and this pool is inside the Tehran nuclear research reactor, which was a gift of the American government to the Iranian government. In the 1950s, Eisenhower thought it would be just great if we could promote peaceful use of atoms around the world. And so Iran was one of the benefactors of Eisenhower's Atoms for Peace program, including this reactor. So this is the reactor from the outside. At 1968, it was kind of out in the desert, and it was sort of there. Now Tehran surrounds this. Interesting piece of our history. Iran's nuclear program goes back to the 50s, especially to the 60s. They are an early signatory of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, so they committed very early on never to develop nuclear weapons. We had this complicated history. There was the war with Iraq. Iran suffered tremendously from weapons of mass destruction. The Ayatollah claimed that weapons of mass destruction are un-Islamic, and Iran would not produce weapons of mass destruction, both gas and poison gas and nuclear weapons. But there were still suspicions about Iran's nuclear program. They committed to building nuclear power station in Bushehr on the Persian Gulf with Russian assistance. They got some assistance from the Pakistani nuclear scientist with technology, and also from North Korea. So, yeah, they say they had no interest in a nuclear bomb, but up until 2003, there were certainly serious questions. 2003, they suspended their nuclear program, nuclear weapons program, and they proposed a nuclear-free Middle East because they thought it'd be grand if Israel also didn't have nuclear weapons. There was a new agreement about this. The IAEA started some inspections of, you know, new plants get started, and the U.S. and Israel launched a cyber attack against their centrifuges. Then we have a new president, 2009. Obama comes in, and he wanted to change the tone of interaction between Iran and the U.S. So he sent out, every year he was president, a New Year's greeting to the Iranians. And the first year, he had this quote from Saadi, the famous Sufi poet, "Bene adam azaya yekdigaran, kedar afarinish zayekuharan," that the children of Adam are members of the same body because at creation they came from the same jewel, the same essence. It's a poem which actually is inscribed in the UN building in New York. It's interesting, in 2010, the pressure is mounting on Iran to you know, make concessions one kind or another. And there was a delegation from Brazil and Turkey, which negotiated secretly with the Iranian government and basically achieved all of the known concessions the Americans were demanding. But by this time, Obama's administration was so committed to sanctions that they wouldn't hear and wouldn't consider what the Turks and the Brazilians had negotiated. So that was another opportunity lost. More serious negotiations started in 2013. And then finally, in 2015, we get around to the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, this breakthrough nuclear agreement. It made it through the House and the Senate without getting totally sabotaged, and it went into work. And a few things about it. One is it's not bilateral. It's not just the U.S. and Iran. It's, it's China, Russia, Britain, Germany, France, the EU, and Iran. So a lot of countries buy into this. And it made some major concessions and major progress. It's the strongest non-proliferation agreement ever negotiated. Unprecedented inspections reduced Iran's centrifuges by two-thirds, gave up 97% of their stockpile of nuclear fuel, and permanent ban on nuclear weapons development, which Iran never admitted they were doing. In return for which Iran was promised sanctions relief, not much of which they ever got. So that's just another summary of the breakthrough things. That was a major accomplishment, and the sense of the Obama administration is you can't negotiate everything in one agreement, so we'll do this, and hopefully we can build on this and get more trust over time and address our other concerns in the region. So it didn't talk about the missile program, and it didn't talk about Iran's activities in Yemen, Gaza, and Syria, or Iraq. Then we have this fundamental question. Does Iran or did Iran have a nuclear weapons program? And there's not consensus on this. And there are reasons to think they might. They have been involved in nuclear research since the 50s. They have some secretive facilities they established. Why do you do things in secret? Well, there's probably some good and some bad reasons to do things in secret. They are very technically sophisticated. They are surrounded by enemies. And they've learned that there's a deterrence value to having nuclear weapons. The Israelis seem to feel threats are deterred, and certainly the North Koreans have felt that they're safe for having nuclear weapons. And countries like Libya that gave them up, not so much. But maybe not. Maybe they never had a serious program, certainly not since 2003. There are different fatwas or religious declarations by the Ayatollahs against nuclear weapons and weapons of mass destruction. Iran does not have a history of starting aggressive wars. The last one was in 1775. Modern Iran has not occupied any neighboring country. There's been rigorous monitoring by the IAEA, which has not provided proof of a weapons program. And Iran certainly did honor all of the terms of JCPOA. So the real question isn't whether or not Iran could have a nuclear weapons program. It's whether they want to. It's a political decision. It's not their competence. And I'm a little discouraged by how even opponents of Trump often end up parroting some of the claims he makes as being true. Repeating over and over that Iran is the world's greatest sponsor of international terror. Well, Iran's not the nicest country when it comes to international behavior, but I can think of a number of countries I put higher on the list of sponsors of international terror. So why did Trump decide to violate the agreement? Well, probably because Obama made it. And if Obama made it, then Trump has to do something else. And Obama was black, after all. And Obama made fun of him, so therefore, I mean, it's as good a reason as any, I don't know. But another major reason is John Bolton. He's been He's now the National Security Advisor, and for more than two decades, he's been calling for bombing Iran and changing the regime there. Why does he do that? Well, over the decades, he has also gotten a lot of money by talking to the Mujahideen al-Khalq. He's gotten over $180,000 in speaker's fees for doing that. And so that might influence John Bolton's thinking. There's also some strong influence from Netanyahu and some very wealthy Jewish donors to the Republican Party. But in spite of that, there are a lot of Israeli security experts, former heads of Mossad, senior generals, who think the JCPOA was very good, and it's a major step backwards to be destroying it. And of course, the Saudis don't like having Iran as a powerful neighbor, so anything to get rid of that. So Trump has embarked on this maximum pressure campaign, and it's got a lot of steps in it. The Muslim ban disproportionately affects Iranians far more than any other country that's included in that list of six. There's over 1 million Iranian Americans. And if you get your statements from Social Security, some of you may be at that age, one of the languages that they come out in is Persian. I mean, it's that big a minority in our country at this point. He declared a little over a year ago, the departure from the JCPOA for who knows what reason. And then Pompeo comes up with this list of 12 steps that the Iranians must take if they want to end all of this pressure. Well, this 12 steps add up to unilateral surrender. And no country is likely to do that unless they've been totally defeated in some military conflict. In April of this year, Trump declared the Revolutionary Guard in Iran to be a terrorist organization. Now, that's a part of the Iranian government. It'd be like declaring the National Guard in America to be a terrorist organization, or the SEAL 6 teams or somebody like that. So it's never happened before that a part of a national government's been declared a terrorist organization. Pompeo, even this week, is claiming that Iran has links to Al-Qaeda and ISIS, and that would give him legal authority, or the administration legal authority, to launch a war against Iran if that were true. It almost certainly is not true that there are significant links between the two. We know where the 9/11 attackers came from. We have a pretty good sense of where Al-Qaeda and ISIS get their funding, and it's not Iran. And we know that Iran has suffered tremendously from Al-Qaeda and ISIS over the years because of the Sunni-Shia split. In all of these sanctions that Trump has imposed, one of them had to do with shortening the period of time that could be spent working on transforming the plutonium reactor into something more peaceful that could not be used for making plutonium. Well, Trump cut that period of time down even to make it more difficult to implement these things that we should be interested in if we want to stop Iran from having nuclear weapons capacity. But what seems to be pushing the Iranians more than anything else is the refusal to let them engage in trade, not only oil, but also metal, aluminum, and steel, and also making it almost impossible to import food and medicine. Those are supposed to be exempt under the sanctions, but the secondary sanctions Trump has imposed basically make Europeans and others afraid to sell things to Iran. Pompeo has this litany of complaints against Iran that he's recently made. Some of these may be true, some of them pretty sure are not. I'm pretty sure that Iran is not behind a car bomb in Kabul, that the Taliban take credit for. The issue of the tankers being attacked, well, who knows? It may well be Iran. Iran has threatened to not let anybody else export oil from the Persian Gulf if they can't. But at the same time, why would Iran attack a Japanese tanker when Japanese prime minister is in Tehran trying to negotiate a way out of this mess? So it could be Iran. It could be one of their militia groups. It could be some proxy group. But it could also be another country who would like to see Iran involved in a war with the United States. Bob Gates used to say that the Saudis would be very happy to have a war with Iran, that there would be fight down to the last American. You know, the Saudis aren't so interested in losing their own people in this campaign, but if they can trick the Americans into fighting Iran, that would be a great victory for them. Saudi Arabia might be interested in doing this. Israel might be interested in doing this. Israel planted a lot of false information, which was parroted then selectively by the Trump administration to justify sending the Abraham Lincoln and bombers and other ships to the Gulf area. Israel claims to be very clever at stealing files out of warehouses in Tehran. So, you know, sabotaging a couple of tankers would be probably something they could do if they wanted. I'm not saying they did. I'm saying we don't know. And I think perhaps the more important issue here isn't who done it. Maybe it's why. Why would Iran even think about doing something like this? Well, for over a year, the United States has been engaged in economic warfare against Iran, making life miserable there. The value of the Iranian currency is about, I don't know, half or less than half of what it was a year ago, a quarter. People lost life savings. The unemployment rate's gone sky high. And it's only going to get worse as long as the sanctions and limitations on Iran continue. So a sense of desperation, Iran could feel that, well, we're never going to be stronger than now, and we need to increase our negotiating leverage. And that, if it is Iran, that would be the logic. If it's somebody else, it's because they want to have this war. So this is a mural for the Battle of Chaldiran between the Safavid and Ottoman empires. It was fought in what's now eastern Turkey. It used to be part of the Safavid Empire in 1514. And this mural is on the wall of the Çalsatürk Palace in Isfahan. And that's a pretty exciting mural, people with swords and guns and cannons. But what's telling about it is only one side has the cannons and the guns. That's the Ottomans. And so unsurprisingly, the Ottomans won and the Iranian Safavids lost. So why then did the Safavids decide to make this mural and post it in their palace in Isfahan? That sort of glorifies the valor of the Iranian soldiers and their willingness to die and suffer for a cause. Against overwhelming odds. It's happened before, could happen again. I think it's important to recognize that Mr. Trump and his team are quite isolated in their campaign against Iran. Only Saudi Arabia, Israel, and the United Arab Emirates are clearly behind his efforts. There's a very long list of countries who oppose it, including all of the signatories of the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, the Iran nuclear agreement. Anybody who has been buying oil from Iran would much rather continue doing that than have their economies upset. Don't let Mr. Pompeo convince you that he's got a bunch of allies out there in his campaign. U.S. has been doing some things to try to destabilize Iran in addition to the sanctions. We've supported labor union unrest in Iran, which is unfortunate for the labor unions because then they become tarnished as being lackeys of the Americans. He's championed the Mujahideen al-Khalq and they have a horrible reputation inside Iran. They managed to convince John Bolton and Pompeo and Rudy Giuliani that they are the answer to Iran's problems. But during the Iran-Iraq war, they actually helped Iraq against Iran. So there are not very many people inside Iran who would like to see them come back. It's useful to mention that not only did Giuliani and Bolton get these large speaker fees, a number of Democrats also got these large speaker fees. I think a lot of people were not very well informed. We're happy to get speaker fees because why not? Reza Pahlavi, the son of the former Shah, has his supporters mainly in America who would like to go back, and he and his supporters have gotten some funding. And then there's this interesting phenomenon called the Iran Disinformation Project. This is a program funded by the State Department, which is supposed to attack misinformation that's put out by Iran, propaganda. But it's been used, been funneled through these organizations that support the Trump administration to attack Americans who oppose the Trump administration. And this should be quite illegal under our laws to use funding to do things like that. And so Mujahideen Khalq is one of them. The Foundation for Defense of Democracies, you'll hear a lot on the news. They get most of their funding from Israel, right-wing groups in Israel, from Saudi Arabia, and from right-wing billionaires in America. They have a very clear agenda promoting war with Iran. So what's Trump's objective? And I think this is the main confusion we have. It's not at all clear. It feels like the run-up to the Iraq war, where things happen and you get the official spin on it. What's encouraging is a lot of people aren't buying it this time. I think there's a lot more skepticism of what Trump is trying to sell. Certainly, Europeans and Japanese are saying, well, give us more proof. And it's interesting the Japanese would say that because it was one of their tankers that was attacked. I think the current administration has such a poor reputation for truth-telling that a lot of the world doesn't want to be tricked into another war. Who benefits from this? Well, the people that hurt are the Iranian people who are already suffering a lot. But the parts of the Iranian government you might want to hurt have ways around this. So the Revolutionary Guard and the Basij and these different groups, they can smuggle goods into Iran. They have businesses they run outside of Iran to get income. They're not doing so badly under the sanctions. Maybe Trump hopes the Iranian people will rise up against the government. Unlikely. Who knows? It's possible. The hope that Iran will violate the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, well, after a year of American violation, perhaps Iran will. And they're pushing the limits of what they're allowed to refine in terms of nuclear waste, nuclear material, uranium. This is something that would be very easy to reverse. Iranians are consciously doing that, and they're being public about it as an effort to try and put pressure on the Europeans. And there's this issue of secondary sanctions I kind of mentioned, but it's worth thinking about just a little bit. It's not just America imposing sanctions on Iran and America violating the agreement. America is insisting that everybody else also violate the agreement and everybody else also join these sanctions on Iran. So the Europeans want to keep the agreement alive, but they're being forced to violate it by accepting these sanctions. And Iran's left for a year saying, well, you're trying to save this agreement, but what's our benefit? Why are we doing this? Why are we suffering? Is it a prelude to invasion? Or they're hoping Iran will do something foolish and spark a war? I don't think Iran would do that, but it's very easy for things to get misinterpreted in this environment. Iran What's their reaction? Well, they don't see any point in going back to negotiations with Trump because, you know, he broke the last agreement so blithely. Put the United States in violation. How can you trust him for anything else? You know, the moderates who negotiated the agreement have been greatly weakened in Iran. Who's going to stand up now and try to save the agreement? Iran did offer a prisoner exchange. There are a number of Americans being held there. You met one of the former prisoners a couple weeks ago here. Was it last week? And they would be happy to exchange some of those for Iranians being held in American prisons. Americans have not responded to that offer. They used to think that, well, we can just wait Trump out, you know. He's 2.5 years into his first term, and if we get somebody else, then we'll be able to deal with that next party. But the pressure is getting so much, it's not clear that that's going to work. Iran does have some pretty sophisticated IT people. They could engage in cyber warfare against other countries and neighbors. And they do have some impressive asymmetrical war capacity, sadly developed by their other activities around the region. Europeans are still committed to the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. They'd like to avoid a war. I think, be very reluctant to accept, even with more proof, more evidence that Iran deserves to be invaded. They have a law called a blocking statute, which officially makes it illegal for European companies to follow these American sanctions, but in practice, that hasn't worked so well, and European companies are afraid of not being able to work in America. They've promised to develop something called S-Techs. It's essentially a barter system, so Iran could buy food and medicine in Europe by swapping goods for that. But this has been very slow, and so far, not even one transaction's been done. So Iran is saying, Europe, is this the best you can do if you really want to save this agreement? They talk about strategic patience. Other reactions? The Chinese have already imported a whole super tanker full of oil after Trump's deadline, and I think they'll continue to do that. India would like to import oil, as would Turkey. Russia is still working as closely with Iran as they can. Russia's not an oil importer, but they have common interests in Syria, and they have common other interests. Anti-American interests. Iraq has strong cultural, religious, and trade links to Iran, and certainly needs to continue buying electricity from Iran, but would also like to continue as open a border as it could. A lot of skepticism about what America really wants to do. But my final points are that Iran is not Iraq. The population of Iran is about 83 million people. That's more than the combined populations of Iraq and Afghanistan. The area of Iran is much larger. It's larger than Afghanistan, Iraq, and Syria combined. Iran has not been devastated by war like some of these neighboring countries has. It's very sophisticated technologically. Iran's regime is unpopular at home. And I found very few people who were enthusiastic about it, and a lot of people who could not wait for the Iranian clerical regime to go. But we know that when countries are attacked, people rally around the government. It happened in Iran after the Iraqis invaded in 1980. It happened in America after the 9/11 attacks, and people rallied around George W. Bush. An American war against Iran would probably not achieve the interests of changing the regime. You've probably seen a map like this before. How odd it is that Iran would locate itself in the middle of a bunch of American military bases. And these are of different sizes of bases. Some are quite large and some are quite small. But If you were Iran, you might feel some sense of being threatened. And this is a map which shows the range of the different missiles that Iran has developed. Certainly the whole Persian Gulf is covered by all of their missiles. And some of them will go as far as Egypt. So they have not invested in more airplanes. They strategically invested in missiles. Why? They suffered a lot in the Iran-Iraq war by rocket attacks by the Iraqis. So they've got lots of rockets, and they can fire them. And so that's probably their main deterrent at this point. Now, this is not an oil tanker. This is a naval ship. And this is, it's a photoshopped picture, but it comes from a war game that was fought in 2002 called the Millennium Challenge. And in this war game, an American admiral played the role, Marine general, I guess he was, played the role of the general in charge of the Iranian forces, and he launched a surprise attack, and he sank an American aircraft carrier and a bunch of American ships in the first 20 minutes of a war. And so then the planners of the war games had to call it off and start all over again, because that was not the result they wanted. They changed the rules, and then the person who was supposed to be in charge of the Iranian forces quit because he thought it was not fair to change the rules. Because obviously, if you're in charge of the Iranian forces, you would make your own rules. They overwhelmed in this war game the American naval ships with massive attacks of missiles, more than the defensive capacities of those ships to shoot them down. So I don't know, it may or may not be possible to live this out, but it's something that probably the Iranians are aware of. This is public knowledge, and certainly the American military is aware of this, and they're probably not as eager for war as some others. So here we are. Trump has brilliantly cornered himself, where he is now demanding Iran abide by a deal he has already reneged on. And this is it. I mean, this is our dilemma. How do we get out of this? And what should the U.S. do? Well, we should get back in the JCPOA. We shouldn't have left, and we should get back in. And if we were in, we could work with our partners, the Europeans, the Russians, the Chinese, to negotiate our other concerns with Iran. It's unlikely that Trump will do this, but I don't know. He's able to turn on a dime when he feels like it. I could hope he could. It would be nice if the U.S. could facilitate humanitarian trade with Iran. We weren't able to give anything of significance after that horrible flooding in March. I'm strongly in favor of promoting tourism and cultural exchanges between Iran and America. Nora and I have had three very rewarding trips to Iran in the last few years. Iranians are incredibly hospitable people. The food is great, and it's an incredibly inexpensive place to travel. A lot of good value for money in terms of hotels and anything you want to buy. But also it just sort of breaks down misconceptions. I'll admit I was a little anxious going back this time, wondering if in the age of Mr. Trump, Iranians would be a little less happy to see Americans, but no, that was not an issue anyplace. And this last thing is my own thought. Nobody else is pushing this, but I wish that we would work not only with Iran, but other oil-dependent countries to transition their economies away from dependence on oil and fossil fuels. And I guess this is my main frustration. You know, I think we have some real problems we can't afford to avoid. Climate change, we have opioid epidemic in this country, we've got migrant issues, housing problems, and we never have enough money to deal with these things, but somehow we could easily be tricked into another $1 trillion war with Iran. Totally unnecessary and unforgivable. When we were in Iran a few years ago, we found this exhibit on a wall in Isfahan. It was a competition for children to make artwork for peace messages. And so there are dozens of different messages, but this is just an example of what war does. All these happy people running into this box called war, and they come out in wheelchairs with amputations. And people in Iran know how much they suffered in the Iraq war. And they know how much they really would not like to have another war like that. This is our good friend Saadi in his tomb in Shiraz. And this poem, I think I read it earlier, about children of God, children of Adam are members of the same body, because at creation they came from the same essence. So that's the end of my little presentation.